comic books typically follow 3-act structures and include protagonists, but they're unlike any other storytelling mediums. Comics can be adapted into films, and films can be turned into comics, but there's something unique about how comic book creators tell a story. In a way, they have no physical constraints. Think about a massive event like DC's Blackest Night. Geoff Johns and Ivan Reis crafted a story that took readers across the universe and packed in hundreds of alien species as DC's finest heroes took on the personification of death itself. And it somehow worked on every level. But if Blackest Night was adapted into film, the large scope, multiple locations, and large number of characters would likely create a production nightmare and sky-high costs that limits a lot of what's actually possible. Instead, the only thing limiting Blackest Night's creative team was their own inability to get something down on the page in time. Of course, writers and artists want to turn in spectacular work with each new issue, and they spend countless hours poring over all the details to do it, but there's only so much they can do. Every action and extra hour spent has associated opportunity costs. For example, the longer a writer spends developing the perfect dialogue in one scene, the less time they have to focus on how the conclusion shapes up. Similarly, the more time a penciler spends on mundane imagery takes away from how much detail and wow factor they can pour into potential splash pages. With only 24 hours in a day, tight deadlines, and sometimes multiple projects on their plates, creators tend to develop their own shortcuts to get as much done as possible. One of the most noticeable and effective shortcuts in comic books is the use of repeat panels. The method can be used to help showcase a return to emotional normalcy, or even display repeat actions in a training montage. But most importantly, it helps the artist get through books a little bit quicker. Hell, I do the same thing in a much smaller capacity all the time on this channel. As some of you may have noticed, this exact image of a white wall appears in the background of practically all of my videos to save a bit of time. While this is a common technique subtly used in countless comics, two instances stand out in particular in my mind. The first takes place in Marvel's Alpha Flight number 6, written and illustrated by John Byrne, and is appropriately titled Snowblind. Snowbird, one of the book's lead characters and the team's resident shapeshifter, finds herself squaring off against Colimac, a being who can generate powerful snowstorms. Right at the beginning of their confrontation, Colimac generates a blinding storm that blankets the page in white. The two square off in a tense battle, exchanging blows and tumbling around the Arctic, locked in combat. Of course, none of this fight is actually seen, as Snowbird decides to transform into a polar bear whose white fur completely blends in with the setting. There may be panels of various shapes and sizes, occupying space throughout the 5-page sequence, but they all look exactly the same, enabling Byrne to finish this portion of the book significantly quicker than a normal fight scene. In many ways, this is the equivalent to simply alluding to a battle and allowing the reader to fill in the details with their imagination. The only difference here is that interspersed lines of dialogue and narration give readers a structure to follow along with as they imagine their own brutal, snow-covered fight. It could be read as a lazy decision. I mean, the bear didn't have to be white in a snowstorm, but it's also a hilarious creative choice that puts the reader in control of the action and gave Byrne more time to focus on the writing, penciling, and inking duties he was pulling on the book. What makes this particular example even more absurd is the fact that Byrne was one of the biggest creators at the time. He had yet to jump over to DC and relaunch Man of Steel, but his work with Chris Claremont on Uncanny X-Men had already turned him into one of the most popular comic book artists at the time. So the fact that one of his books featured nearly 5 blank pages would be like opening a Jim Lee Batman comic and discovering a third of it featured Bruce Wayne replacing a light bulb in a pitch black Batcave. Either way, you have to give Byrne credit, because even though he may have had a lighter workload on that particular issue, he confirmed in an online Q&A that he was paid the normal rate, because then Marvel editor-in-chief Jim Shooter considered it an artistic choice. The other infamous example of repeat panel images I want to highlight, which also doubles as a bit of meta commentary on the phenomenon overall, comes in Invincible issue 10, courtesy of Robert Kirkman and Ryan Ottley. Mark Grayson may be a superhero, but he's also a comic book fanboy himself. And upon discovering that his favorite creator, Brian Michael Bendis, Flip Schaff, is signing at his local comic shop, he waits in line for some autographs. When the two finally get a moment alone, Mark comments in awe about Schaff's ability to release new books on a monthly basis. Perhaps revealing a bit too much about how the sausage is made, Schaff actually replies that he reuses a lot of his art for dramatic effect, and even insists that most fans don't notice the time-saving trick. You can practically feel the awkward silence hanging in the room after the artist makes his comment. Schaff may be fictional, but he's right, and even the repeat panels here, of two people just staring blankly at each other, add some pizzazz and tension to the otherwise unremarkable moment. The stillness, while comical, also generates the sense that Mark had to abruptly process the revelation before figuring out how to respond. There are two fully silent panels, devoid of any movement, before Mark finally replies to the creator. Similarly, the artist, now replying to Mark's accusations of cheapness, takes two still panels worth of time, which could feel like either 5 seconds or 5 minutes for Mark in the middle of this awkward moment, to muster up his defense of the practice. No, it's not a cheap technique. A better word is likely cost-effective, and I applaud the creators for cleverly filling two-thirds of a page with two images repeated numerous times. Look closely, and you'll notice that both film and television utilize similar techniques to expedite production. The most basic setup in filmmaking is the shot-reverse shot, and part of why it can be so effective is it quickly and clearly conveys information to the viewer. Imagine a dinner scene between two characters with the camera on a lazy Susan in between them, constantly spinning around to capture each person's reactions and dialogue. This repetitive setup allows viewers to know who's talking, where they are, and what each person's body language is expressing. It's all just done in a time and budget-conscious manner. Instead of forcing the lighting department and cinematographer to develop new shots, placing the camera on the ceiling looking down at them, for example, it's often more efficient to simply keep things consistent and repeat setups. Sure, there may be more entertaining ways to shoot a conversation, but similar to comic book artists who repeat panels when two characters are talking to spend more time constructing the perfect splash page, filmmakers understand that certain shortcuts are appropriate in order for them to maximize their time on flashier aspects of the movie. Comic books are just one tiny part of a ridiculously fast-paced entertainment industry. While television shows take breaks in between seasons and movies crawl through development for years, comics are on the shelves week after week. Sometimes writers and artists can get ahead of schedule on titles before they're even announced to the public, but creators still have to do everything they can to stay ahead and consistently meet deadlines. Burnout is very real. Comic creators may be doing what they love, but that doesn't mean they enjoy pulling all-nighters or avoiding their family to slog through work. Creating comics may look like a lot of fun from the outside, and that's definitely part of why I want to do it at some point, but it's hard work that takes the dedicated talents of numerous people to release even a single issue. So knowing all this, don't be mad when you see repeat panels pop up in a book. Just trust that the creators are doing everything they can in the time they have to give you the best reading experience possible.